Hi, welcome back to Liquid Audio in Perth, Western Australia. Liquid Audio, cherishing classic audio. And today I have a very, very special item to talk about, and that is this absolutely beautiful, in fact, I mean drop-dead gorgeous, Yamaha CA-2010 integrated amplifier. Now, Yamaha really are up there with the very, very best when it comes to some of the design and build and styling elements of their electronic equipment, especially from this era, which is sort of late 70s. This thing came out, I think, in 77 and was probably sold for about 3 years up until around 1980. It's a very powerful, heavy integrated amp. It's 120 watts a channel. Weighs about 21 kilos, and it also operates in Class A at a greatly reduced power output. You can see the Class A switch right here. If you want to do that, you can change. Obviously, that then changes bias to the output devices, and whilst dramatically reducing power output, should dramatically improve sound quality. So, this is a bit of a beast. It requires some work. One channel drops in and out. I suspect that it is completely original. I don't think anything's ever been done except people have sprayed in the usual horrible contact cleaners, which don't clean, they just line everything with a sticky residue. So I'm gonna have to go in here and wash this thing out and give it a good overhaul. So let's have a bit of a look inside and we'll take the lid off and check it out further. Let's see if we can do that without with just one set of hands. This may not be possible. Yes, it is possible. Okay, so we'll put that down on the ground, and this is the inside of the CA-2010. Now you can see, really, in terms of build, there are lots of very kind of Accuphase-like build elements to this. Design-wise, it's built very, very well. I mean, you've got shielded boxes, which we expect from high-end gear. We have a layout of the amplifier modules that is incredibly similar to the Accuphase E303 that I worked on recently, which is a MOSFET amp. This is certainly one of the best made integrateds that I've worked on in a while. And as you know, I work on quite a lot of these. I mean, just these, for example, these universal joints. I mean, these are some serious universal joints. You know, these are really, really high quality joints. And that was all so that they could angle their thing. And you know, this is obviously some preamp kind of board under here. So we'll get to that a bit later. But these two amplifier modules, I mean, this looks exactly like, or almost exactly like in terms of layout, and even in terms of fastening via these big long bolts, the Accuphase E303 that I worked on and restored recently. You know, it's very, very similar in its kind of layout. So they've really borrowed some styling elements, I guess, or some design elements, I should say. They haven't borrowed any styling elements. To me, this looks way better than almost any of those Accuphase pieces. I much prefer the brushed aluminium finish, almost a satin. It's so finely brushed that it's almost a satin. Got those beautiful power meters there on the front, and then the trademark narrow switches. The knobs that they use, but Yamaha use those trademark narrow sort of flat style knobs, really like those. And these switches are also classic Yamaha. So the Yamaha styling DNA is very, very evident in this piece. But some of the build quality and so forth is the stuff that you can't really see becomes evident when you look under the hood. So yeah, it's a lovely piece, really, really nicely made. I've got two large filter capacitors. They're 22,000 microfarads each. So they're quite beefy. So we've got 44,000 mics of filter cap. They're reasonably high voltage as well, which bodes well for the overall design. 71 volts, which means that there are some nice, you know, reasonably high voltage rails in here, probably 60 or something volts, or at least 50 volt rails we'll have in this. So I'll have a look at the service manual and then we'll get into to overhauling this old girl. Okay, so with that panel removed, you can see this is all of our selector board. With a couple of interesting looking Yamaha custom sort of hybrid IC type arrangements there, little modules. Some tantalum caps around those, some trimmers which probably are for like offset or local voltage regulation perhaps. But yeah, so there's some signal switching and stuff happening on this board. There's also some FET packet, what look like dual FET packages there. So probably what I'll do Someone has been in here too, and you know, there's a crack on the board there. There's a big crack through the board here, which is interesting, and a broken screw. So something's happened here. I'm not quite sure exactly what, but I do feel like I need to probably take this board out, which probably isn't going to be that easy, actually. There's going to be a bit of mucking around here to do. Now, on the other side, let's have a look the underneath, if we can. God, it's heavy, this thing. There we go. So that's a look at the underside. And so we've got power supply, regulation, and so forth there. That's that board. Got a very nice multiple gang Alps volume and balance control there. And then some other Alps controls for, like, what is that, bass and treble? Yeah, bass and treble. Bunch of switches there. It's sort of our tone amp, probably, that board there. And then a few other miscellaneous, you know, switches and controls. But you can see that this thing is quite a beast. Now, one of the problems is Yamaha has eschewed the use of connectors and gone for soldered connections, which is great, sort of great from a signal path point of view, but it's a real problem from a serviceability point of view, because all these have to be desoldered, of course. So, you know, it's going to be a bit of work to do on this old girl. Okay, we're out here with the CA-2010 because we have some problems on this input selector board. You'll notice there's a nice big crack. I hope you can see that. Nice big crack going through the board there. You'll also note that it is covered with just years of built-up contact cleaners and crap, and no one's obviously noticed the elephant in the room, this crack. And in fact, when you look on the other side, and I'm hoping I can zoom in and show this, if you can see this, sorry about the wobbly camera work, but can you see how it goes right through a whole bunch of traces there? This crack is actually quite serious. It goes through a bunch of traces, goes through that whole ground plane there, and then it goes through three or four signal traces. So, yeah, that's a real problem. So anyway, I'm going to do some cleaning now, and just see if we can make some progress here. There's unfortunately a lot of old cruddy contact cleaners and all sorts of residue and crap inside this amp, so it needs a wash. So we'll give it a bit of a wash, and we'll keep going from there. Okay, we're back here with the Yamaha CA-2010, and I've just been working on this main function selector board, which is obviously a critically important board in this amp, because all the signals enter in here and then are routed according to the position of these mode, phono, and record out and input selector switches. So the big problem with this board, actually, there were a couple of things. Obviously, it was pretty old. It was very dirty. Loads and loads of sort of old stale contact cleaners and deposits and residue. So I've cleaned all of that off. I've washed the board. In fact, I've washed most of this amp at this point. But there was this big crack that went right the way through the board. You can see it on the top there. Now, in fact, what had happened was, I don't know if you can see the silk screen on this board for the traces underneath, but in fact, it went almost all the way through all of these traces. This crack sort of propagated further across and went through most of those. So most of those traces were broken. And my feeling is, because the customer reckoned he was getting intermittent signal, I guess on certain inputs or something like that. I can't quite remember what he did tell me the symptoms were. But what is that? The phono? Yeah, this is for the phono selector. So I'm guessing if he was listening to records, there would definitely have been problems that would have featured a thermal component. So there would have been some thermal cycling and probably some correlation with the fault developing as those thermals, as the unit warmed up. But anyway, so the way I fixed that, I use a super glue, or, you know, the correct name is cyanoacrylate. That's a special kind of glue, but it's commonly known as super glue. So I use that to fix the board. And then what I did, what I always do with these sorts of things, hopefully you can see this, I bare new copper and then go through with some solder. And I'll just try and zoom in to give you a better view of this. I hope that's not too wonky. Sorry for the handheld. It kind of looks, you might think that there are still cracks there, but I promise you there aren't. It's just sort of an optical illusion. Or some shadowing in the case of that little solder there. So yeah, you can see I had to go all the way through to the other side of that red cable there, right to that one there, you know. So it went through even that one. It went through a couple underneath the red cable, as you can see. And so it really went through that whole bundle, and then it went through even where the board was attached, you know, to the chassis. So that's all repaired, and of course I've cleaned this board now. The other thing I've done, I've replaced the electrolytic capacitors on this board, all except for a couple, and I even found some goofs. There were some factory installed goofs where some of the parts were wrong, you know, so I've sorted that out as well. And yeah, so we've got some really nice new parts in here. This thing's going to sound fantastic. Obviously, this will have fixed the intermittent phono fault. And I'm also, the next thing I'll probably do here is put this board back in. I'll then take out these amplifier modules and we'll go through and we'll refurbish those as
okay,
well.
Okay, so we're on the other side now of the CA-2010. This is the underside. And this is the power supply and regulation board. It looks like protection as well. Some muting functions perhaps there. I don't know, but there is a relay, so it probably switches rails on or power on or a mute circuit or something. So this is all power supply stuff. These transistors were very, very loose. These are the probably series pass regulators. They were just they weren't even screwed down. I mean, those screws were just spinning. So that made me sort of think, well, I'm going to pull this whole board. I'm going to replace all of these caps, I think, just because probably a sensible thing after this age. And power supply obviously is super important in any amplifier. It really determines the sound to a large extent of any given product. So yeah, I think we'll go through and do that. And yeah, I'll come back when that's done. All right, making progress with the CA-2010. And I have essentially recapped the whole board. Although you might notice that there are maybe four caps there that I've left in place for very good reason. It's those four big ones here. I actually pulled and tested them and they measured better than the new caps that I had here to replace them with. So, you know, given that they're vintage, they're very cool, they're exceptionally high quality parts and they measure and test perfectly, I thought we'll leave those four in. And I've replaced all the smaller ones. Now, some of the smaller ones were starting to show signs of wear, especially a couple in this area here. So I decided to replace the smaller ones and, of course, cleaned and, you know, defluxed the board. And so that board is now done. So the last little thing, or the last thing I think I'll do on this particular amp is get in and work on these amplifier modules. So that'll be next. Okay, this is the last phase of, it's the second last phase of what I'm doing on the CA-2010. I'm going to overhaul these two modules, which means pulling them apart, replacing the electrolytic capacitors on these boards, and obviously attending to any dry joints, doing some thermal improvement perhaps to some of these drivers, and to the output devices. I'll probably mount those on sill pads and those other drivers, yeah, we'll put it back together then we'll do some cleaning and lubing of all of the rest of the switches and controls, and then we'll test and see how she performs. So yeah, nice little modules. Again, very Accuphase-like in the kind of, in terms of the look and the layout. You know, FET input. These are bipolar output, not MOSFET, but, you know, nicely designed, nicely laid out. One thing that Yamaha really goofed on, which has been endlessly annoying for me, is no board designators on any of the parts. I mean, they tell us really useful things like it's a resistor. Ah, thanks for that. It looks like the semiconductors are numbered perhaps, but in terms of the board designation, just resistor and capacitor. I mean, I had to search through schems and try and figure all this stuff out when I was working on the other boards just to work out what parts were what and what values were what. So yeah, thanks Yamaha. Okay, so here we have the two finished overhauled modules. You'll see that I had to pull out a whole bunch of mica washers, an old thermal paste, TO3 style, and TO220. I even replaced the little these little things. I even replaced these. I've got supplies of those. Obviously, I've got, you know, loads and loads of sill pads and more sill pads. And yeah, you need all these things if you're going to be doing this kind of stuff. You know, there's no point in mucking around. You want to do it properly. And look at the results. I mean, they look amazing. The finished module just looks fantastic. You know, it looks much cleaner. To clear up a couple of things, if people have questions about this, look, in theory, a really good mica washer, and I mean, when I say a good one, I mean a really thin one, a proper thin one, with fresh thermal paste on both sides will outperform a sill pad like this. But the problem becomes when you're dealing with old micro washers or thick micro washers and very old thermal paste that's degraded and become dry and crumbly, like it was here and like it is in most cases. Now, in situations like that, the sill pad will definitely outperform that worn and degraded thermal interface. So this is definitely, in my opinion, a better way to go. I just prefer this method. I really do. It's look, it's aesthetically pleasing, but it's sort of mechanically reliable long term, and it's very easy to rejuvenate, with minimal mess and fuss. So we've remounted those drivers and the output devices. I've remounted these on thermal paste, but I haven't used sill pads for those guys. But you know, anyway, it's just easy just to use some thermal paste there. There's the other one, and you can see the rejuvenated modules. So what else did I do? Well, I replaced the electrolytic caps. These were all tiny little 1 microfarad caps with sort of not terrible ESR. They were actually still okay, but I've replaced them with 1 microfarad film caps, 100 volt film caps. So, you know, these are all just rail decouplers, and goodness me, the performance of these things. I mean, just to give you an idea, the original 1 microfarad electrolytic caps had an ESR of about 2 ohms, 2.5 ohms. These things have an ESR of like 0.05 or less ohms, 0.05 ohms or less. I mean, extraordinary stuff. In terms of shunting noise to ground, these things, which is what they're doing, they're just decoupling the rails. So these things will bypassing the rails, I should say. I've had a very long day. These things will have dramatically improved performance. So really, yeah, much, much better specs, much better performance in that role. Why didn't Yamaha use them originally, you might be wondering? Well, no, they were just trying to cheap out, save a little bit of money. That's why you'll find various cheap parts in amps like this. You know, they whilst I was likening this to an Accuphase in terms of layout, which it is, it certainly isn't in terms of parts quality, not even close. Accuphase used extraordinarily better parts in most cases. These are very Accuphase like, these Micron ceramic resistors, but you know, the other parts on these boards are not in Accuphase territory. The semiconductors are, they've used good semis, but you know. Anyway, those are the two refurb modules, so we'll put those back into the amp and then we'll be doing a power on test. Right, we're just back with this CA-2010. What I've had to do with this rear panel connector board, you know, this rear panel board, these boards on all these integrated amps from Japan are always dodgy. You know, you've got dodgy switches, you've got dodgy sort of wobbly RCA connectors. In this case, they were broken. I've epoxied the retainers, but the switches were also broken. Somewhere at some point, this thing has just been absolutely smashed, and people have bodged in some repair wires, and there are lifted traces and all sorts of rubbish. So really the best thing, what I've done here, you can see I've just directly bypassed all of that. I've just directly connected, I should say, the pre-out with the power in. And in that way, we just do away with all of this bodgery and dodginess. And hopefully, you know, that will reduce some of the issues that we're having here with this amp, which is sort of some signal path problems. Put this back together now and test it and see how we go. Okay, the CA-2010 coming along. I'm trying to power through this job now. That signal path issue that I was having, I think I may have mentioned, I completely bypassed this horrible panel here, which is, you know, filled with problems. So that's bypassed. The other thing I had to do on this particular unit, I had to pull apart and service the protection circuit relay, which is underneath here. So I had to just do all that again. Well, when I say all that again, I just had to pull the board, remove the relay, clean the contacts, polish the contacts, reinstall the relay, test the unit, etc. Now that's completely fixed my signal problem. So that's good. So doing that rear panel board and repairing and servicing the relay has fixed that signal integrity issue, and it's now working beautifully. What I'm now doing, adjusting DC offset, you can see we've got less than a millivolt there, and we've got like 1 millivolt there, but I mean, you know, anything within a couple of millivolts is just superb. And yes, I'll try and tweak that out to get it below one, but they do vary. It will sort of vary thermally a little bit. It goes up and down. As you can see, this one, it sort of oscillates around zero. I'll just tweak that one to get that one around zero. Then the last thing I'll do is the distortion adjustment and the meter symmetry. So I'll do those adjustments. Next time you see me, I will be doing the cleaning of the exterior. So you'll see me back in just a few minutes. But not before I talk about the biasing, which I can't believe I forgot to include. Don't know where the clip is, but here I am setting bias for the Class A operating point, 300 millivolts per channel. It's a lot of bias. This thing draws 175 watts at idle when it's operating in Class A. Obviously quite a lot less in regular Class AB. Very quickly, these are the parts out of the CA-2010 that I changed. You can see there's quite a few electrolytic caps, plus a whole bunch of mica washers, which we've replaced with sill pads, of course, and these little insulating washers where the screws mount the TO220 devices. So I've replaced those with new ones. So yeah, that's, not a massive number of parts, but a good swathe of parts. And this was more of a repair, actually, tracing a number of, signal path issues, including that cracked function selector board, a relay problem, and so on. Anyway, all good. Coming back very shortly with the just about finished. Sorry, one last look at the adjustment process. This is adjusting the phono preamp for distortion. So what you do is you null out the distortion, minimize the distortion, notch it out. And what we're doing is we're feeding in a signal, 20 kilohertz signal at minus 10 dBV. I'm using a different procedure to the one described in the service manual because, to be honest, the one in the service manual is not helpful at all and just overloads the phono pre. Whereas this this feeds in a sensible signal and lets you null out minimize out the distortion. So in both channels now, we're down around 0.002% with sensible signals fed to the phono pre, which is very cool. So really happy with that. So great result. Phono pre's adjusted. The whole amp now is adjusted. And we'll now do the final finishing touches.
Just a quick look at that protection relay while I had it apart.
Well, here she is. This is the fully repaired and overhauled Yamaha CA-2010. So as you can see, I've given her a very, very good clean. She looks amazing. The fascia looks beautiful. I've also cleaned and waxed the cabinet. So hopefully you can kind of see that. Get a bit of an idea there of just how beautifully rich that wood now looks. It's nice and nourished. It's just a beautiful cabinet, isn't it? Really, really nice. So yeah, there she is, the CA-2010, working beautifully. Every control and switch is now dead quiet. Bias is good, DC is zero. All the inputs work, the meters are now calibrated. What else? Yeah, repaired the signal path fault. There were a few issues on the function signal input board, and there was another set of problems on that pre-out power in board. So I bypassed all of that. And yeah, look, it's just a very, very nice piece. Beautiful amp. I would suggest to anyone using one of these, if it's all biased up correctly, and that means that it's drawing about 175 or 180 watts out of the wall in Class A mode, I'm just going to put this on the table and tell you that thermally, this thing really shouldn't be dissipating 180 watts from this fan cooled heat chassis. This is a chassis that relies on convection cooling. It's just through this little sort of section here. Now admittedly, this is where the heat sinks are, yes, but there isn't a massive amount of ventilation. The bottom panel isn't hugely perforated or anything like that. It's I just don't honestly believe that this thing can dissipate the power that it's rated to dissipate. So I don't recommend using it in Class A mode. I recommend using it in Class AB mode. But anyway, that's just that's a recommendation, perhaps especially useful for here in Australia where it gets really hot, or in Perth anyway. If you live in a cold climate, you can probably get away with it and it'll heat the room as a nice little byproduct. So that's a bonus. But anyway, so that's the Yamaha CA-2010. That's a complete it's not a full restoration, but it's a complete overhaul and a repair and service. And she's running very well. If you'd like me to look at your Yamaha CA-2010 or any of the other CA series, 710, 610, there's a whole bunch of them. Now, if you'd like me to look at yours, please get in touch with me, Mike, from Liquid Audio in Western Australia, liquidaudio.com.au. Thanks for watching.